As you travel around Alaska, you will find a wide variation in climate, from a temperate maritime climate along the southern coast, to a continental dry climate in the interior, to an Arctic desert climate north of the Brooks Range. Depending on latitude, elevation, or a location adjacent to certain topographic features, a multitude of very different climate zones can dominate. In addition, Alaska's climate is changing at an unprecedented pace, and we're seeing high temperature records being broken quite frequently, while more stagnant precipitation patterns seem to invite longer wet and dry periods. The ocean has a moderating influence on the climate of coastal regions, while inland, a dry continental air mass dominates the summer months. Most fire activity occurs across Alaska's interior, between the Alaska Range in the south and the Brooks Range in the north. Fire activity also occurs in a few more sheltered areas of the south, including the Copper River Basin, the Matanuska and Susitna Valleys, and the Western Kenai Peninsula. Although green in summer, most of these burnable areas are just a bit wetter than an Arctic desert, averaging 12 to 20 inches of precipitation a year. In the northeastern interior, the Yukon Flats are even drier, with 8 to 10 inches of precipitation annually. Much of this falls as rain in late summer from late July into August. Because of widespread expanses of permafrost across Alaska's interior, heavy amounts of precipitation are not well absorbed by the soil. Typical interior summertime high temperatures are between 65 and 80 degrees Fahrenheit, with an occasional near 90 degree period. The hottest and driest areas are found in the Yukon Flats and the Tanana Valley. Daytime RH is typically 25 to 45%, but may be as low as 15%. Lowest humidities usually occur before greenup in late May and early June. 20 to 24 hours of daylight provide extensive drying and heating and create flatter temperature and relative humidity curves. On the longest days, near the summer solstice, there is very little RH and temperature recovery. As a result, the burning period can be from about 0600 to 2300, depending on how far north you are. Lightning is the main ignition source for fires in remote parts of the state, while human ignitions are the primary culprit along the road system. Though lightning ignitions consume larger acreage, most of those acres are in less populated areas. Of course, this isn't always the case, and lightning ignitions near villages and cities require rapid IA response. Thunderstorm activity occurs anytime from mid-May to mid-August, with the most activity during June and July. Storms typically form between noon and 8 p.m., though may occur late into the evening. Lightning is most common in the southern interior, but is seen across all parts of mainland Alaska at times. Both wet and dry lightning are known to cause new fires. Ignition is more dependent on the pre-existing fuel conditions in the upper duff layers than on how much rain actually comes with the storm. There are three critical weather patterns that exacerbate fire behavior in Alaska. To forecast, plan, and monitor these patterns, we use the 500 millibar level to determine the main steering flow. This altitude is about 18,000 feet above the Earth's surface and is above most frictional effects. It's not quite above Denali, but for the most part, this works. In general, flow moves along the geopotential height lines that you see on these maps, moving clockwise around a high and counterclockwise around a low. An upper level ridge and its subsequent breakdown brings the most lightning ignitions to Alaska. It usually starts with an upper-level ridge over Canada that pushes into Alaska and lasts for several days or even weeks, drying fuels. As the ridge weakens, unstable air moves in along the edges, bringing dry thunderstorms to the periphery of the ridge. though little or no thunderstorm activity occurs directly under the ridge, as the ridge retreats into Canada, the advancing thunderstorms bring dry lightning to those areas that had been sheltered under the ridge axis. Therefore, breakdown and subsequent ridge movement is a significant critical fire weather pattern across much of the state. It is helpful to know what the 500 millibar flow looks like for this pattern. Here you can see that the flow moves westward over the southern part of Alaska, then wraps around the ridge and dips back to the east-southeast over northern Alaska. Southerly flow aloft is another significant fire weather pattern for the interior. In this situation, high pressure builds in from the south, bringing moisture to coastal areas and creating strong, drying winds or Chinook winds along the north sides of the Chugach Mountains, the Copper River Basin, the Alaska Range, the White Mountains, and the Brooks Range. Winds can be funneled and become very strong through mountain passes near Healy and Delta Junction. Any fire activity or new ignitions will have rapid development due to winds and dry fuels. Thus, this is another critical fire weather pattern. Again, knowing the 500 millibar flow is key in identifying this pattern. The more tightly packed the lines, the stronger the southerly winds will be. Though from the opposite direction, northerly winds will also bring very dry air despite colder temperatures. This pattern sets up with high pressure over western Alaska and low pressure over Canada, or with everything rotated clockwise, the high over northern Alaska and the low over the Gulf of Alaska. Either setup may lead to strong northerly winds, clear skies, low humidity, and cool temperatures. These strong north winds will funnel and accelerate through mountain passes, increasing fire danger in many areas. This critical fire weather pattern has brought extreme fire behavior to parts of South Central, often later in the season, with very low RHs around 10% and winds gusting into the 20s and 30s. All of this with temperatures being well below 70 degrees. It is therefore a critical Alaska fire weather pattern. The 500 millibar flow pattern for this critical regime has two possible adaptations. One where the lines run north to south, the straight northerly flow, and another where they lean from northeast to southwest, with the flow coming in from the northeast. Either setup will bring that cool, dry air throughout the state. Patterns that slow fire activity are equally important to understand. There are two critical weather patterns that can slow or end the Alaska fire season. Backdoor precipitation is important for the way in which it can subtly bring large amounts of precipitation into the eastern part of the state. It begins with a low pressure center in the eastern Gulf of Alaska near Yakutat. That low begins to move northward, often repositioning in the Copper River Basin. This wraps moist southeast flow from the Gulf of Alaska and over Canada, which works in from the east to bring rain to Copper River Basin, the upper Tanana Valley, and even the upper Yukon Valley. The difficulty is predicting how much moisture will make it through Canada and how far westward it will reach. Some of the wettest summers in the interior have occurred when a series of these lows moves through the eastern Gulf of Alaska and, over a period of several days or even weeks, deposits a lot of rain. The backdoor precipitation regime is considered a season-slowing event, though it may be a season-ender depending on when it occurs. The 500 millibar flow reflects the counterclockwise movement around the well-stacked low in the Gulf. Southwest flow is the wettest pattern for most of Alaska and usually signals the end of the fire season. When a flat ridge of high pressure builds into the Gulf of Alaska, the upper level flow parallels the Alaska Range. This allows clouds and rain to reach into the usually protected areas of the interior near the Alaskan-Canadian border. If this pattern sets up for several days, it will bring enough moisture to significantly slow growth and even extinguish many fires. One note, the Copper River Basin may still be protected by the Talkeetna Mountains, staying fairly dry. This pattern may be a season-ending event, particularly when it occurs in August and lasts for several days. Note the flatness of the ridge in this 500 millibar pattern. This may or may not be a welcome event, as it also denotes the end of the warm days of Alaska's summer. Alaska is a big state with many different climate regimes. A lot of helpful Alaska weather information and links can be found on the Alaska Interagency Coordination Center website. The best way to stay informed on Alaska fire weather is to start with the Daily Predictive Services briefing at 9:45 Alaska Daylight Time every day of the fire season. A shortened podcast of this presentation is also posted by noon each day. This is meant to be a big picture look at the weather and can clue you in on what to expect. More detailed forecasts for areas and zones can also be found on this site, along with red flag warnings and fire weather watches. There is also a plethora of observational data from weather stations, radar, satellites, web cameras, and lightning detection systems, along with links to the Alaska Fire and Fuels database, which houses weather and fuels information. Don't hesitate to reach out to your predictive services team for assistance with weather, fuels, and fire behavior information. We hope that your time spent in Alaska will be safe but enjoyable.